looking to invest in psychedelics or have invested in psychedelics, this is not the same. We are looking at a completely different model. And the two gentlemen that are sitting with me now are gonna take a moment to explain what their business models are. We're gonna get into that. But we are in the third wave of the psychedelic industry. And for those of you who have not read Michael Pollan's book, How to Change Your Mind, I don't know what the hell you're doing in this room. And if you have read the book, you understand that there has been a tremendous amount of real clinical research around psilocybin and LSD, and as we've heard, iboga and ibogaine and other molecules. What happened, as you all know, in the 1960s is those molecules escaped the clinic and escaped the lab and ran into general public. And there was a massive backlash by the federal government led by Richard Nixon. And it really killed this movement, and the, most importantly, the research and the clinical work on this up until 1995, when Dr. Rick Strassman at the University of New Mexico started to do work on DMT. So we'll talk a little bit about that and how to communicate and how not to scare off the straights in a bit, but first let me introduce Ronan Levy from Field Trip. Ronan, why don't you take a moment and explain who you are and why you're here and what Field Trip is.
Sure, hey, I'm Ronan. I'm one of the co-founders and executive chairman of Field Trip. The co-founders of Field Trip all came out of the Canadian cannabis industry. We were instrumental in really building a clinical infrastructure that took cannabis from being something that was seen as quasi-medical to something that I think a lot of physicians and patients now see as truly medical and therapeutic. We built a business called Canadian Cannabis Clinics and CanvasRX. We sold that to Aurora Cannabis back in 2016. Given that I suspect a lot of investors here are also cannabis investors, you probably know the story of Aurora, which skyrocketed from a very small company shortly before the acquisition to one of the largest medical cannabis companies in the world. We left a couple of years ago, and that's when we came across psychedelics as an opportunity. And immediately, like most people, we saw a lot of parallels, or thought there were a lot of parallels between cannabis and psychedelics. We dove into research. One of our first conversations was with George from Compass, which was a very constructive conversation. We quickly came to the hypothesis that you're gonna see legal access to psychedelics in some form or another, probably much sooner than most would expect. And so we set about trying to figure out how to build a business model anticipating that while these molecules are still scheduled and while companies like Compass or nonprofits like MAPS were 2, 3, 4, 5 years ahead of us in sort of a conventional drug development pathway. And so where we landed was, we don't know exactly what the future of psychedelics looks like. We don't know the legal path that's gonna get across the line first. But there's infrastructure we can start building now, today, that is going to be essential for whatever that industry looks like in the future. And so with Field Trip, our core focus right now is building a large-scale network of psychedelic-focused medical clinics. Our first 3 clinics will be open early this year, starting in Toronto, New York, and LA, starting with ketamine-enhanced psychotherapy, and then we'll scale it beyond that. At the same time, we're making strategic investments in R&D for areas where we see a lot of potential. One is drawing a parallel to cannabis is that psychedelic mushrooms have not been studied in depth. There's over 200 species of psilocybin-producing mushrooms and other plant-based psychedelics, so we're investing heavily into doing plant-based basic research on the fungus and other plant-based psychedelics to identify novel opportunities, new molecules, other therapeutics, as well as anticipating a future market for psilocybin-producing mushrooms themselves, developing the standard procedures and protocols to grow psilocybin-producing mushrooms in a compliant manner that will meet all analytical testing requirements. In the same token, we're making strategic investments in drug development. As mentioned on one of the earlier panels, we talk about LSD, psilocybin, and MDMA primarily, but there are countless psychedelics that have not been studied in depth, and so it's a great opportunity. There's no shortage of opportunity around psychedelics right now, so we're making some investments around that.
Brian, who are you and why are you here?
Well, that's a great question. So I have a couple of different perspectives. So I was, I guess I will call myself an early cannabis investor. I started investing on the private side about 5.5 years ago. And I was doing that while I was the CEO of trail trees. So I was living, I lived in the world of understanding what does it mean to sell a harmful and dangerous product, and what does that mean from a responsibility perspective, and had to live through not being FDA regulated to becoming FDA regulated. And ultimately, you know, I knew at some point I was going to get into the cannabis space full time, so I formed Green Sky Strategy with two, you know, most unbelievable people on the face of the earth. In Green Sky, we have two parts of what we do. One, we're kind of an operating team, consulting group. We go in and help companies who don't know how to run their business, who don't understand when cash is tight, like right now, what do you need to do to really generate cash flows and have operational strategies. But we also have a second part of our business, which is really kind of why I'm here. We have a holding company structure, whereas we're kind of scouring the landscape. We identify what we think are interesting business opportunities, and then we put our team in place to build those out. And so we're putting together a company called Mogu, and Mogu is a not only a psilocybin, but also an adaptogenic focus company. And I think a lot of the panelists who came today, you know, I actually agree with a lot of what they've said around being science-driven, the need for clinical approaches. And everybody in this space, whether you believe that adult use will happen or this is going to be only a pharma pathway, needs to adopt that same mindset. That's kind of part of how I wired through the tobacco experience. So what Mogu is all about is we really have kind of three prongs to our business strategy. We're trying to have a near-term revenue growth opportunity that helps fund the long-term clinical development. So we've built a great network of unbelievable partners that include unique grow technologies. So one of the things that regulators do not like when you're talking about organic materials and natural variability. So partnerships on the grow technology side to produce consistent, efficacious products. We've also got a Schedule 1 DE lab that's going to be doing all of our clinical work and formulation work on the drug side. But you know, we're starting in the near term focused on adaptogenics. So there's a lot of low-hanging fruit. There's big opportunity out there. So Lion's Mane, Reishi, the varietals that are available there to really provide everyday relief to replace medications. And so that's really important to me because, you know, a couple of years ago, I had a kind of traumatic experience that led me to a really severe bout of anxiety that, you know, happened when I was driving on a highway, and literally I was unable to drive behind the wheel of a car on a highway for 2.5 years. And it was crippling and debilitating, so I've really become passionate about, you know, plant-based ways to deal with those types of ailments. So I think adaptogenics is a space that we'll be going to market in this year with, you know, proprietary blends and formulations going to consumers. We also have a line of grow products for the decriminalization efforts as they roll. We want to reduce the barriers for those people who are in the space today who are actually want to or interested in growing their own psilocybin, for example. And those efforts are really our kind of short-term revenue stream that are going to fund the clinical development of not only microdose dosages for potential adult use, but also for more therapeutic applications as well.
So this is an investor conference, and we've talked a lot about science, and we've talked a lot about not the investor side of this. And there are journalists here from Business Insider, which is a major investor publication, the Wall Street Journal, Cheddar. We are now 50 years into the war on drugs. And you know, these molecules, these drugs have been demonized. I mean, everybody in this room has heard Just Say No. Everybody in this room has seen the commercials of this is your brain, this is your brain on drugs, and this is not okay. So while you are not consumer-focused companies right now, you will potentially eventually be. How do you educate the consumer market that this is not your brain on drugs, right? What are the messages? What are the vehicles? How do you tell your story?
You know, I think it starts with education, and that has to be backed in science. I mean, we have never been at a time where consumers are craving more information about the choices they're making, no matter what they're doing in their life, whether they're deciding what hotel to stay in or they're deciding what to put in their bodies. So I do believe that the science is critical and important. So if I think about for us on the adaptogenic side, you know, when you watch what's happening like in the CBD snake oil world, it's really disheartening because there are, when you don't start with the science and how to actually think about consumer applications backed by science, the world falls apart. So that's where we start. And then from a from a consumer standpoint, a lot of people think about barriers or things you can't do, and I just view that as it just forces you to be creative and think about what you can do. And so when you get into the the psilocybin space, and if you think about potentially a world where there could be adult use there, again, I think therapeutic centers are going to be a really important role or ways to have consumers be coached to get that full experience, because it's really not something that you should just plow into on your own. So I believe education is really critical. Then let the consumer decide.
What about you? How are you guys, other than us, how are you educating the market as to what Field Trip is, and most importantly, demystifying the fear around whether it be psilocybin or any other psychedelic?
I think Brian touches on it correctly. It's evidence. Like, if you lead with the evidence, the conversation becomes fairly easy, right? And I think we live in a world now, especially in North America, where cannabis has paved a very easy road. There's been a lot of minds changed over the last 5 years in particular, from total resistance to skeptical, views to now total acceptance. And so I think that's made it a lot easier conversation. When we have the conversations with people, typically, usually there's a raised eyebrow for about 5 seconds, and then kind of talking about, people ask questions about bad trips, and they talk about the evidence about how there's no such thing as a bad trip. There's a hard trip, but when done in a therapeutic context with the right support, it can always be therapeutically positive, and the conversation just moves along really quickly. Now, there are other things that are happening in society that make the conversations easier besides cannabis. I think growing conversations around mental health and mental fitness, and how that's a lifelong commitment, makes it easy. Dealing with the fallout of the opioid crisis and growing distrust, whether justified or not, associated with pharmaceutical companies and people turning back to more holistic approaches, there's just a whole bunch of convergence of trends. It's made the conversation actually quite easy overall.
So you guys have both either invested or raised money in the cannabis space. Can you talk a little bit about the difference when you are sitting in front of, whether it be a family office, a high net worth individual, or an institution, when you're trying to pitch, whether it be Field Trip or Green Sky? Ronan, talk about the experience, because you're closing a round, potentially going to raise another round. So what has the experience been when you're actually pitching your company?
The biggest difference has been that almost all the investors who are interested in this space are interested because they've had personal experiences, profoundly positive personal experiences, either directly or within one degree of their family members. And there's also a whole movement, with a lot of interest from Silicon Valley and tech investors, because in addition to the trends I talked about earlier, optimization, longevity, performance, so those are the sort of terms du jour these days that everybody seems to be focused on, and psychedelics fits right into that. So it's a different base, it's an easier conversation. Certainly a lot of cannabis, but there's a lot of people that made a lot of money in cannabis, and they're a natural investing base because they see this as the next big swing. There are a lot of differences between cannabis and psychedelics, but at least on the preliminary blush from an investor perspective, they see it as the next big home run, or as Graham Saunders at Canberra used to say, the next grand slam. So it's been a pretty easy conversation, but those have been the natural base of cannabis investors, as well as family offices or high net worth individuals. So,
I'll echo something that Ronan said, which is, I think it's about, it's not just about getting money, it's about who do you want money from, and what is their interest, what is their intent. I personally think that matters a lot. What matters to me is who I work with, who are my partners, and what are their motivations and what are their interests. So, people who are looking at the space are there for either a personal reason, or that's driven them to really start to do the legwork to understand the science, to understand what's going on with a lot of the great companies here today, and FDA, and history of psychedelics. So that, to me, is where we start, right? If you have to really push to educate someone, to convince them, I don't want them as an investor. And that might sound, like hubris, but I think long-term, you want investors who buy into and understand what the long-term vision and opportunities for the space.
For the cannabis space, and we'll stick with the investor stuff for a little bit, there was a pretty clear path to monetization, right? There were already medical cannabis cannabis states, right? We knew that in 2012, there was a passage of adult use in Colorado and Washington. So there was a clear view, like, I'm going to be able to put money into these companies. They're going to start to generate money quickly. In this space, it's fundamentally different. This is much more of a pharmaceutical model where it could take 5-10 longer time. And the costs associated with bringing these drugs to market and commercialization can be tens, if not hundreds of millions of dollars. So when you're talking to institutions who historically, like 10 years, have not invested in the cannabis market, are there pharmaceutical investors, institutional pharmaceutical investors, who are looking at you differently? Are you pitching a different cohort of people than just the traditional, and I hate using the word traditional about cannabis investor, but the traditional cannabis investor? And Brian, you can go first on this one.
I think that, how I think about that is, again, it informs kind of our strategy and kind of our operational strategy, which is, you do need to understand that on the psilocybin opportunity and the psychedelic compounds, that is going to be a very long, expensive, clinically, scientifically driven process. But that's also why we do think there are nearer term kind of revenue generation opportunities in the space that are actually aligned to the overall mission of how can these compounds that are available and readily available in legal varietals of mushrooms, be leveraged to create good in society. So kind of how we answer that is, we have a near-term revenue strategy that will help fund part of the clinical drug development side of our business. And you're absolutely right, like it is a different mindset. If someone is looking for, hey, what's my return going to be in 2020 or 2021 versus what's the opportunity over a 5 to 10 year time horizon. So it really is, again, by I think knowing your audience and really understanding up front, what are they looking for from an investment opportunity, and how are you going to be a fit?
So Ronan, part of your business model, you mentioned it earlier, is clinics. Right, you're opening up your first three clinics in the next few months, the first one in Toronto, then we're going to see here in New York, we're going to see in Los Angeles, potentially other cities. How does that play to the investor audience?
Yeah, so I mean, our investor audience to date has not been typical pharma or biotech investors. It's been more high net worth and tech entrepreneurs, that kind of stuff. But our belief is that, and our whole business model is based on the thesis, this is coming much sooner than most people expect. Certainly the clinical trials are going to happen and they're very likely to succeed. Fingers crossed they succeed. But for one, psychedelic-assisted psychotherapy is here now. Ketamine just needs to be repositioned to be seen as a psychedelic as opposed to what most people often think is, of course, tranquilizer or an anesthetic. But, it's just changing that discourse. And really, because our operating thesis, although we follow the evidence, is that the psychotherapy, the mystical experience, for lack of a better term, is integral to the outcomes. I know a lot of work and investment is trying to remove that from the conversation, but we actually like that because we think it changes the overall conversation that's happening in medicine, where the last 100 years or so have been driven by an allopathic medical approach where you give a drug to treat a problem, whereas integrative medicine is becoming much more transparent. It's all about preventative medicine and the integration of all the systems in the body. So we like to have that conversation, and that conversation is not a conversation for traditional biotech players, but we think there's revenue to be generated now, we think there's a brand to be generated now. We think, we see the ballot initiatives in California and Oregon, which seem very likely to move forward. There's a good chance you'll see the same constitutional battle that happened in Canada back in 2001, which created legal access to medical cannabis at the time. That's almost certainly going to happen sometime this year or next year. And so the markets are going to arrive, I think, a lot sooner than most clinical FDA trials. And so that's, again, why we built our operating thesis on, we don't know what gets across the line first, so let's position ourselves to be nimble and pivot and participate on whatever that looks like.
And I think to add, I think it's also can be a positive for the development of the industry for capital to have a longer term time horizon. And I think that part of the downfall of cannabis was, as the first panel was talking about, the green rush, right? People looking.
By the way, that's the name of my podcast.
For the here and now and the return today, and what's the exit? when is, you know, big company X gonna buy me and make me a millionaire? And that led to a lot of bad behavior from a competitive perspective. And then as soon as that capital turned off, which happened this year, I mean, the cannabis industry in California is in this moment having its little mini version of the financial crisis that the country experienced in 2009. The capital is turned off, bills are not getting paid, money's not flowing, and companies are going bankrupt. And not just slow companies, like big names that we all know and have heard. So I also think it is important that longer time horizon, and again, I agree with Ronan, I think there's a lot, you know, if you look at the initiative in Oregon, you know, what that regulatory landscape looks like, what the state-specific legal adult use medical landscape looks like, it's all going to evolve, and actually, the more it evolves, I believe, more slowly, the better off we'll be.
So, Sam, actually, why don't you stand up for a second? Sam is running the campaign in Oregon to structure a medical psychedelic market. So after this is over, everybody take out your checkbook and write Sam a check so that we can get this done. But the real question, I mean, I have a question about this, which is, and I don't mean to put you on the spot, my friend, is that the right structure? Or is the FDA structure the way to go? Do we want to go the same way that cannabis went, which was a state-by-state, market-by-market structure where we start with a medical program and eventually evolve to adult use program? Or is the best way for this industry to really become an industry the FDA route? What do you think, Brian?
I think it's both. I mean, I think it's one of the limitations of modern medicine and drug development that you have to define the condition that you're seeking to get drug approval around, and depending on how you define that and how you define the patients in your study, you can be successful or not, whether the drug is effective or not. You know, it's just a question of statistics, not necessarily efficacy all the time. And so I like the idea of giving people a choice where there's a more holistic, natural approach where people can participate whether they're sick or not. You know, I think one of the things that we're excited by, and a lot of people in this room are probably excited by about, is the expansive potential of psychedelics. People who are quote-unquote healthy normals, we all have trauma, we all have shit to deal with. All of us can be better off by using psychedelics in a properly controlled setting. So I really like what Oregon's doing. I think it's a smart way to do it. It's controlled, it's risk mitigating, it gives people access whether they're sick or not. It gives a natural alternative as opposed to a synthetic, which seems to resonate with a lot of people. So I think pursuing both is great, and I think there should be two systems that are operating side by side, one a purely medical and synthetic approach, and one that's a more holistic, natural approach that's available to anyone who wants to participate.
Yeah, I agree. I think, you know, both matter. I do think on the state-by-state approach, you know, there are lessons to be learned from the cannabis experience, so, you know, anytime you have a gray market or a black market for a product, how you think about regulation, how you think about taxation matters. So that's a unique aspect of any state-specific regulation. You know, I also think that, you know, this sounds like a holy grail, it's unachievable, but, you know, to the extent that states start to go, you know, having a broader voice for the entire industry to help guide more harmonization, I think, is something that the cannabis industry did not get right. And I think some of the East Coast markets are being a little bit more methodical and learning from that experience. But I also do believe that FDA plays an important role, both on the kind of clinical drug development, pure medicinal approaches, but also from an overall oversight. I mean, I'm also a huge proponent of very strict standards that are not defined once a state becomes legalized for adult use or medicinal use on dosing, product requirements. You know, we shouldn't be in the business and trying to figure out what are the test methods, right? So all that work has to be done, and if it's done in the right phasing, I think states can go in a way that's still beneficial for the population as a whole.
So whether this is a pharmaceutical model or a clinic model or whatever model, you guys are going to have to market your product, whether it be to doctors or to patients. And we've seen the massive explosion on television of advertising for every drug that passes FDA approval. Last year, you know, we tried to get the very first cannabis ad on TV and it was rejected, which was expected. So yes, we did do a stunt for for Acreage. Ronan, how do you plan on marketing your clinics? How do you plan on talking both to referring doctors who can send patients to you and to do patient recruitment?
Yeah, it's similar markets to what we adopted or approach we adopted to marketing our cannabis clinics, which is you have to be prudent. At the end of the day, the success of our centers focused on psychedelic-assisted psychotherapy is going to be driven by our ability to get buy-in from the local medical community. So being too outlandish, pulling stunts like that, which I really appreciate because I've had previous businesses, is not something that's in our playbook, at least for the foreseeable future. Leading with the evidence, driving successful PR campaigns to educate doctors and patients about the availability of these services, the benefits and the limitations. That's one of the things that was critical to the success of our last business and actually driving adoption of cannabis for therapeutic purposes across Canada. As we said, this isn't for everybody. This is not a panacea. We will not prescribe to everyone. We will only prescribe to patients who are appropriately using it. And that really changed the conversation. And so I think we can take a lot of lessons from that playbook and drive it forward here as well.
So Brian, you've got other products that are beyond psychedelics. How do you plan on marketing, whether it be the lion's mane or the turkey tail or the other mushrooms and the home grow kits?
Yeah, I think on the adaptogenic side, it is a much kind of clearer kind of consumer-driven approach, but I still think it is, this is a very community-driven environment today. And so leveraging that community and really being trusted and being a thought leader and growing that community and being part of that movement is kind of part of our strategy. So we've got some great advisors who have been very active in the space for a very long time to really help guide us and be authentic. But also we still need to reach out to the people who are suffering but might not think or know that this is an adaptogenic varietal that might actually help them. And for us, that strategy really helps us build a brand in a more traditional CPG way. Obviously, in a 2020 technologically driven way. But that also creates the foundation for us. Then we can lever. So if you think about the microdose MODU products that are administered in a therapeutic setting, that we have that halo and that credential and that trust from the consumer that they're going to know what's there, that it's tested, that it's backed by science.
I'm going to ask one more question and then I'm going to turn it over to you guys. We've got somebody from MAPS here who everybody in this room should thank because we're not for MAPS. But they have a different business model, and USONA has a different business model, which is the not-for-profit business model. And there is this tension in this industry of the not-for-profit model and the for-profit model. Why? Why is there this tension? And what do we need to do to address it? And like, just talk about this, the for-profit versus not-for-profit model.
We are unabashedly for-profit, and it's not because we're ruthless capitalists. In fact, we're in the process of getting registered as a B Corp right now. But it's because we think for-profit model is the best way to scale. And the truth is most of the conversations we've had with the active participants in the nonprofit side of things, including MAPS, including USANA, they get it. They 100% get it, and they're not opposed to it. The pushback tends to come from more of the community, the activists who have concerns around for-profit approaches. And their concerns are valid. We're experiencing the opioid crisis, which was capitalism run amok, right? And so I think it's just really about trying to keep an open dialogue, being conscious, and then doing this in a thoughtful manner. And I think a lot of those concerns can be allayed, and I think we can all work cooperatively and productively to the best possible outcomes, which, from my perspective, is helping the most people either heal and deal with traumas or other neurodegenerative or inflammatory diseases, or help people expand and live more empathetic, creative, happy lives. And if we do that, then we all win. So I think my sense is it's been overly cooperative so far, and it'll continue to do so because the people leading this on both sides of the for-profit and non-profit have the same attitude of we want to work together.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I think it's critical that both work together, and I think it's also important that even for-profit entities, and every company you've heard from today, I think has a very clearly articulated mission about what they're trying to accomplish. And yes, although creating revenue, and it's true with us too, you know, creating revenue and profit is what's behind the business, but it's also about creating good for the community and better outcomes for individuals. You know, but even in our case, you know, we were having this conversation, you know, one of my co-founders, Ophelia Chong, you know, she said it, for her, it's critical that, you know, we're giving a part of our profits to MAPS, for example, to support the nonprofit side, and that those two sides of the industry have to coexist and work together to create a truly sustainable environment for business.
Why don't you stand up for a second? For MAPS, why don't you stand up for a second?
So
MAPS is, if everybody, yeah, MAPS is in the house. MAPS is phase three trials for MDMA for treatment of PTSD. They are raising funds to get through to the end, to end point, to make sure that we can, anybody who has PTSD has access to that. So another person you guys want to write a check to is that young lady right there. Okay, so now we'll open up the questions.